will. And don't, oh, thank you. Thank you, Dad, over there. Do not share answers. This is a independent project, all right? Independent. Oh, and by the way, you have to have a Bible. You have to have a Bible to do this, right? Always should come to the text. Always come to the sermon with your Bible if you would. So good. Praise the Lord. All right. So we are ending our short, it's a short book, four-week sermon series. Actually, there's a sequel. Woo! There's a sequel coming next week. It's the book of Nahum. If you know your minor prophet order, which is hard for me to this day to remember, but it's Jonah, Micah, Nahum. And these two books, they go together. And we'll find out how in a little bit. But first, we've been going verse by verse. We call this expositional preaching. We start with the text. We let the text speak. We apply the text, and we end with the text. In a healthy church, I believe, I think this is shared by many of us, serves up a regular diet of expositional preaching. It's preaching that exposes the meaning of God's word to God's people. We're like treasure hunters. We're going back in time for ancient truths that are still relevant today, and then we try to understand them, apply them, and live them. Also, expositional preaching is preaching that understands what we call biblical theology. That God has revealed himself progressively from Genesis to Revelation. And what's more, this progressive revelation is a story, a wonderful story of redemption. You'll hear us talk more about biblical theology later. It's also preaching that proclaims the confidence that we have in the message of the gospel. Solomon and I, as we were preparing for the sermon this week, and I emphasized to Solomon again, every message, Solomon, that you preach, there is a gospel word. There is a word of hope, a word of power for the hearers. And so we're always looking for that. Yeah, in the Old Testament, right? Wow, wait, I thought the gospel came in the New Testament. Actually, it's all over the Old Testament too. And so we're looking for it. And the gospel message is this, that Christ has died for sinners, and that through his death and resurrection, we will be saved if we will simply turn from sin and trust in his finished work. And when we say saved, we mean saved not only future, you know, saved from the wrath to come, but also saved now from the power of sin, Satan, and the world. So anyway, if you aren't already there, please turn to Jonah chapter 4. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you would use this book today, this ancient book written 3,000 years ago. We pray, Lord, that by its words, by its message, we would be transformed. We'd leave this room looking a little more like Jesus. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless the speaker, open our hearts. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hey, some people think of Jonah. When they think of Jonah, they think Jonah and the whale. Of course, it wasn't a whale. It's a great fish. They think of a child story, a children's story. But I'm here to say that Jonah is not primarily a children's story. Although if you go on Amazon and do a search, you'll find 669 results for all these different cute books that I found today. Wow. It's all about Jonah and the whale. The whale, again, it wasn't a whale, a great fish, gets mentioned only twice. He gets two verses. The story is about Jonah, and the story ultimately is about us. So, but yeah, there is something definitely a takeaway for kids. Kids can follow the story, no problem. But the subject is much more deep than than maybe a child can understand. And so we're taking this text seriously. Jonah's not this cartoonish figure that gets swallowed by a whale. And as we take this text seriously, we're trying to rescue it from our moralistic culture's interpretation, our moralistic culture's infatuation with self-improvement. The world likes to see Jonah as this cautionary tale, a moral lesson about loving people who are different from you. And hey, yeah, there's that. But we need more than moral tales to fix this messed up world we live in. We need more than, we need nothing less than the gospel, God's power to change hearts, if we're going to love our neighbors, especially our enemies. So it's not primarily a children's story. Again, though kids can certainly get something out of it. Instead, it's sophisticated satire. This is a satirical book. A satirical book that looks at the wicked heart of man. When I say man, I mean all of us. We all, by nature, are you ready for this? Hate God. And we hate him for things like what we saw in chapter 3, his scandalous mercy to the wicked. Remember I told you about satire? What is satire? It pokes fun, ridicules someone or something in order to show how ridiculous or unrighteous or simply wrong they are. And when it comes to who Jonah is, rather, when it comes to who God is, Jonah knows real well who God is, but he can't accept him for who he is. And this is true for a lot of people. A lot of people know who God is. They look at the heavens that declare his glory, and they know who God is. They have a heart with the law written on it, and they know who God is. And of course, they have the word of God, and they know who God is. And after they figure it out, they want nothing to do with him. And again, this is what we see in chapter 3. We saw this scandalous mercy that he shows. And we imagine that God is for us, of course, and he's against our enemies. Right? But turns out not so. Yes, he's for us. He loves us. And he loves our enemies. Uh-oh. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise. Some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but all should reach repentance. All means all. Preachers love to say that. So let's go back to chapter 3. Chapter 3, you've got Jonah finally fulfilling his first commission, which was chapter 1, to go to that wicked great city of Nineveh. Again, just for review, don't underestimate the brutality, the incredible wickedness of Nineveh, which really does give us a little understanding for why Jonah was reluctant in the first place to go there. And you know, if you were an Israelite, if you were a Jew living in Jerusalem, and you heard that the Assyrians were 10 miles away, you would literally wet your pants. You would be so terrified. You'd run for the hills. They were merciless, merciless, brutal. They were brilliant in their warfare, and they executed their reign as the first mega empire, if you will, of the ancient world. They did it very well. And for many, many centuries, they were in power. And they tormented Israel. Actually, they wiped out the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom, and they were constantly coming against the southern kingdom, the two tribes there. Well, so anyway, he goes here in chapter 3. He finally goes to Nineveh, and lo and behold, and he preaches a sermon. Remember how many words it was?
A few.
Okay. Five words in Hebrew, and I heard eight in English. And lo and behold, they repent. And so now we're in chapter 4. Jonah is still hanging around Nineveh here for a little bit. And, we're not told what he's doing, but one thing we know for sure is that, lo and behold, as they believed, as they repented in sackcloth and ashes, everybody from the king himself down to the animals, no drinking water, even they were very serious about it. Godly sorrow. God has indeed relented. And this is a principle that we could never forget. And maybe it's already ingrained in your mind. But when we repent, God relents. When we repent, God relents. I sometimes forget. This is a picture, by the way, of Nineveh 100 years later. I don't know if you can see what's going on, but it won't be a happy ending. Not the kind of ending that we see here in Jonah. But that's, again, a sequel coming up. So God has relented, and when we repent of our sin, he relents and saves us. Here, nothing happens. Judgment is postponed. And the final chapter is yet to be written. And again, we'll see that as we start our sequel coming up next week. But here in chapter 4, he prays. If you want to call this a prayer, I don't know if you really can call this a prayer. Whoops. Looking for my glasses and grab my mic. There. Thank you. Thank you. Solomon, great to have you. Serve with you. He prays. He prays this prayer. And we're going to look at it just a bit. You're going to notice that it's quite different because this is his second prayer. His first prayer is found in chapter 2. But let's look here first and see what's up. It says here, he displeased God exceedingly, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry, and he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? This is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? Here, let me ask you, is it okay to complain to God? You're going through a hard time, a trial, suffering. Is it okay to complain to God? For sure, read the book of Psalms, right? The book of Psalms is filled with lots of complaining. But it's also followed, those complaints are followed by lots of remembering the promises of God. And then lots of trusting in those promises and lots of hope as a result of trusting and remembering those promises. But what is Jonah doing here? He's not doing what he was doing in chapter 2, back in chapter 2. Boy, I was so proud of the young man. He was praising God. You know, nothing like getting swallowed by, getting almost drowned and getting swallowed by a fish and being saved. I guess that leads to appropriate praise. He's thanking God for his salvation back in chapter 2. But what's he doing here? What's he doing here? He's calling God out. Be careful here. He's calling God out. He's calling out God for his identity, for who he is. And who is God? Who is God? Back in Exodus chapter 34, we see who God is. The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and steadfast and faithfulness, maintaining love and thousands to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Amen. He's throwing up this. Did you hear? Did you see it? Did you see the two? Did you hear what I just read? What I just read there? He's quoting Exodus 34:6. He's throwing it up in his face. He's calling God out for, he's calling, this is God's calling card. This is the John 3:16 of the Old Testament. Okay, it's okay to complain to God, but to hate God for being a good, merciful, loving, and gracious God, no. So what's going on here? This is sad. This is Jonah saying here, I know exactly who you are, and I can't stand you. I would rather die. I would rather be dead than to hang around you and be associated with you. Wow. Am I being too harsh here on poor Jonah? I mean, no, I'm just taking his words for face value. And now if I'm God, I'm like, okay, have it your way. Goodbye. Adios. Auf Wiedersehen. Hasta luego, baby. You know, you're gone. No. What does God do with this little schmuck of a prophet? He does what a good, merciful, ever-loving, slow to anger, not willing that any should perish God does. What does he do? He chases after him. He doesn't let him go. He appeals to Jonah. He asks him a question. You know, when we push God away in his love, he comes after us. And that can be hard, by the way. Remember we talk about severe mercy? You know, that can be hard. Or sometimes it's gentle. Sometimes it's that still, quiet voice of the Holy Spirit calling out to you, come back, or would you consider this? Please listen. Read this. Hear this. You know, every time we sin, you know what we're saying, we were doing? We don't get it. We think of sin, we take it so lightly. But every time we sin, we're saying to God, I don't want to be like you. I don't want you around. It's the Garden of Eden all over again. You don't want to be like our Father. Lisa and I told our kids, how many years have we been raising kids, honey? It seems like forever. We love kids. We have 10 of them. And, you know, when they have been caught for lying or cheating or hating or hitting someone, we say, that's not who we are. You're a Grange. We don't lie. Well, we try not to lie. We try to speak the truth. We don't hate. We love. We don't hit. We walk away and seek peace. Amen. Listen, Jonah hates God for who he is. And you'd think he'd be so happy. He's the prophet that gets results. Look at this, you know, put it on my resume. But of course, his animosity for the Assyrians, though justifiable, had become all-consuming. Just blinded him. Why does Yahweh, God, why does God speak? Why does he speak to us in the Word? He wants to show us who he is without us dying in the process. He wants to reveal himself so that we might know him and love him. Amen. And be like him. Amen. So he's given this book for our blessing. But even as we look at this book and we see who God is, it's a mirror. It's a mirror looking back at us and saying, oh my goodness, I don't match up. It's not pretty. My heart is not like God's heart. But God doesn't want us to stay where we are. He wants us to move along. Amen. He wants us to change. Come as you are, but don't stay as you are. So he begins to pursue us. Some have called God the hound of heaven. Sort of rolls off your tongue. The hound of heaven. He's after us. Yes. Wow. That's how much he loves you.
Amen.
Here, you know, here Jonah, the true Jonah, emerges. You know, we saw a change there in chapter 2, but it just didn't stick. You know, and I think about severe mercies that we've encountered in our lives. And we get down on our knees and we cry out to God, help, save us. And, you know, he does.
Amen.
And we say, okay, you know, but if it, we usually he saves us, we usually preface that saving with, oh, I'm going to change. I'm going to start going to church. I'm going to stop sinning. I'm going to follow you. Again, and he saves us. And so we turn over a new leaf. We start going to church, doing what we're supposed to do. Only when things start going well to forget our promise to God. And we go back to the way we were. Am I describing you? So he's obeyed. He went to Nineveh, chapter 3, but his heart wasn't in.